we're running lots of webinars, as many people do. Some of them are focused on only on the creative industries as such. We are at Creative Business Network concerned with from music, movies, fashion, gaming, etc. We're in over 80 countries in the world. But sometimes we focus on the evidence, the scientific side of it all. It's not all fluff and fun and games. That's why we have, this is CBN Science. I am very happy that we have Margherita Bacci Gallupo that will speak to us in a few minutes and be better introduced by my colleague, Benoit d'Albert. But before I give the word to Benoit and Margherita, I know Georgios have some stuff to tell us.
Yes. Thank you, Rasmus. So before we start, I want to remind you that this session is being recorded. During the presentation, it will be wise, as Rasmus said, to keep your microphones muted so the main speaker will not have distracted sounds. And also, please, you are really welcome to open your cameras and use the chat for every question. So please feel really comfortable to open your cameras. So I want to share a tool that is called Mentimeter. Maybe some of you are familiar with it. For those of you who are not, it's really simple to use it. Now I'll share my screen. So you just have to go to www.menti.com and please fill the code that you can see on the top of your screen so you can answer the questions. The first one is quite simple.
Georgios, just a second. So everyone, it was a bit fast here. And so everyone grab your smartphone or open another browser on your PC and write menti.com. And then you can see a code. You can see the code is 6021-1537. 6021-1537. And Jessica, you need to turn off your microphone.
I'm sorry.
It's okay, no worries if you write your name here.
So go for it now. Georgios, you take it from here.
Thank you, Rasmus. So here in the first question, where are you from? We want to see the multi-diversity that we can have in this webinar. So we can see people from Romania, Italy, a lot of from Italy, because we can see it in the center. So we have more than one from Italy, Belgium, Matera, Italy, Guatemala, Greece, France, UK, Finland, Germany, Austria, Switzerland. Okay, more from Italy. The Netherlands. And Guatemala. Okay. I don't know what is Ouagadougou.
It's the capital of Burkina Faso, formerly known as Upper Volta.
Okay, that's why we have Rasmus here. He knows everything. Okay, so for all of you, Ouagadougou is the capital of Burkina Faso. Nice. So let's go to the second question. Let's see where are you? What are you? A creative professional, an education institution, a business support organization, a public authority, investor, or other? Okay. Have three educational institutions, three business support organizations, seven business support organizations. Okay. Have like a derby here between education institutions and business support organizations, but generally we have, as I can see, a diversity.
And you guys, we have 42 people participating right now in this Mentimeter, and only 23 of you are actually participating in this. So all of you, grab your smartphone, write menti.com, and then the code 6021-1537, 6021-1537, and participate. Oh, now we're 25, that's good.
You can keep participating in the next slide. So other, I'm pretty interested to ask in the webinar. So the other are what here? Let's see. Third question. So is creativity a standalone competence, a cross-cutting competence, or a cross-cutting competence? transversal to other key competencies such as digital entrepreneurship, personal and social, and learning to learn. So I think there is only one answer here.
Seems like a really leading question. So there's someone wants to stand out.
Nice, 95% against 96 against 4. Okay, we have an answer here. Let's go to the next one. And what are the main building blocks of creativity? Imagination, curiosity, production of novelty and value, persistence, critical thinking, and collaboration. Let's see your answers.
Here you can choose up to 3 options.
Okay. Thank you, Benoit.
I think we're missing one, which is obstacles. That creativity comes when you are forced to find a solution to something. So maybe obstacles should also be one. But hey, that's maybe something for the debate with our science, with our speaker today.
Yeah. So curiosity is the first one until now. Imagination comes second. Critical thinking, of course, and collaboration. Then production of novelty and value and persistence.
And so, someone has the microphone open, so, and I can't see who it is right now. I'll chase you down.
Find them, Ramos, we'll find them.
Find out where you live. Was it Juan Pastor Bustamante? No, it wasn't, okay.
Okay, so curiosity is the first one, imagination the second one, critical thinking, collaboration, and then production of novelty and value and persistence. So thank you very much. So we'll continue with this after. And now we'll give the floor to Benoit.
Yes, thank you, Georgios. And good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. It's great to have you all on board. 48 participants. It's a very nice participation. We are pleased at CBN to co-organize this webinar with the Erasmus Plus Project Deus. And we are trying today to bridge the gap between science and creative industries and EU projects. So let's see how far we can go within 1 hour. We have the chance to have Rita Orlando, our lead partner, in the room. I cannot see her now, but I saw her at the beginning. So she will say a few words about Deus following Margarita's presentation. But just to get us started with the topic of today, we are talking a lot about creativity. And in recent decades, it has been recognized as one of the key competencies for lifelong learning, along with critical thinking, problem solving, teamwork, communication and negotiation skills, and so on. But at the same time, even though it is getting prominent in many educational frameworks, there's no one way to talk about it, to define it, and to teach it. And therefore, we can wonder if the concept is actually solid or if it is just fuzzy. And this is why we decided to invite Margarita from the Joint Research Center today to talk about it, and we hope to hear from her more. One thing we are going to dive is to check how it can be conceptualized and designed, how it is being taught across the continent, and if we have a couple of ideas that we could take on board for the Deus project, because the Deus project aims at developing a new training methodology for creative professionals. We are talking about vocational education and training. And of course, lifelong learning is a key component for those people to keep up to date with the changing requirements of the labor market. So Margarita, I'm now handing the floor to you. We are always looking forward to your presentation.
Thank you very much. Thank you everyone for the nice introduction and for setting it up. I'm very happy to be here today. And if I'm allowed, I try to share my screen. Screen one.
And while Margarita is sharing her screen, there will be opportunities to ask questions. You can write your questions in the chat, and Georgios, Benoit, and I will make sure that they are being answered. But for now, it's Margarita's time, but write your questions in the chat, and then eventually you can also ask them directly to Margarita. Thank you.
True. You can intervene and ask. Although this presentation is meant to tease you to read our reports, plural. It's four different reports on this topic. And actually, I want to share this slide, if it works. Okay, while I introduce myself and the JRC, I leave this slide on so that you can use the short URL to maybe open the report. The reports, the two main one is the literature review and the final report, which links to an inventory and case study. You can open them and browse. I think that is more or less 350 pages distributed in this different report. So it will take time. I'm just going to introduce the key findings of this report. So I work for the Joint Research Center. The Joint Research Center, also known as JRC, is the research arm of the European Commission. We are part of the European Commission. We are spread across Europe in different sites. I am based in Seville and I work in the Human Capital and the Employment Unit, where we work on key competence frameworks. Some of you may be aware of the Digital Competence Framework, the Entrepreneurship Competence Framework, or the key, the LifeComp one, which is about personal, social, and learning to learn. So this is part of our job that we do within the Commission and for the Commission. So as we are one of the ministry of the Commission, like anyone, any other else, like DG Education and Culture, for instance, but we don't do policy, we do research in support to policy, free from commercial interest or national interest, but we are not independent from the Commission, so to say, we are part of the Commission. Let me see. Okay, this is a slide that show where we are. But the few words I'm going to say about this report are structured this way. So I'm going to talk to you through the context that led to this study, because especially since the variety of the audience is pretty large and there are people that are creative professional, they might find it strange to read the report of 250 pages, 300 pages on creativity. But there is a context behind. I will present the study, how it was conducted, and then the main findings, commonality, differences in across approaches in lifelong learning, in teaching and assessing creativity. So the context, this is policy work. This is the link to the key council to the council recommendation on key competencies for lifelong learning. This is a policy document that was originally written in 2006 to say that education system in member states should promote 8 key competencies, because beyond the subject matter expertise, subject matter teaching, it's important to foster digital competence and literacy, languages, entrepreneurial competencies, sense of initiative and entrepreneurship, was called at the beginning, personal, social, and learning to learn. And all these competencies are said to be interlocked, to overlap, and not being exhaustive, because in the council recommendation, there is an explicit mention to creativity, where the council recommendation states, skills such as critical thinking, problem solving, teamwork, communication, negotiation skills, analytical skills, creativity, and intercultural skills are embedded throughout the key competencies. So we have a spotlight on these 8 key competencies, and we say that creativity and the others that I mentioned here are embedded throughout, are transversal. So we have, yes.
And the council is not just any old council, it's the shareholders of the European Union, the member states actually. So it's the highest level.
Yes, so it's our democratic representation in all this work. So we do the technical work, and in this case, they recommend member states. So member states recommend themselves, basically, they agree that this is priority. Thank you, Rasmus, for putting the highlight on this. So this is the context. Creativity is more and more under the spotlight, but where it is in our key competence framework is said to be transversal, so it has a primacy, but it's not very visible. So we wanted to dig into the creativity topic. So we carried out the study, was actually carried out by Professor Bill Lucas and PPMI. We were more of the editors, so steering the work. And the study ran three main desk research activities, so literature review, analysis of initiative, and in-depth case study. So overall, the literature review, which is published as a separate report, covered 175 articles and 59 existing framework globally on what entrepreneurship as the transversal competence for lifelong learning. So we are not talking something narrow, something very broad, the going beyond school education, especially. So we looked into academic publication, into existing learning frameworks, UNESCO, the key competence framework from the council, but OECD. So very well-known framework that trying to describe what these competencies are, and in specific creativity or creative thinking. Then we identified initiatives, either policy-driven, so something that comes from a government that says we want to embed creativity throughout our education system, or grassroots initiative like the DEUS project itself is a grassroots. It comes from practitioners who say we want to give more visibility. And then we had case study. Given the audience, I would strongly advise you to start from the case study because we have study case study like I can mention one, IDEO, which is their program from Creative Difference. It's a private initiative. So instead of looking at what government do or what large European project, you can start from something that is a consultancy kind of work and see if you find that the information is interesting for you, then you can expand and go to the initiative and the literature review. My advice is to start from very, very tangible outcomes of this research, that is the description of what people actually do in these 8 case studies. Okay, the first finding that maybe doesn't surprise you is that creativity is in the key competence recommendation is defined as a skills that appears throughout the 8 key competencies, a transversal skill here. But in the literature and in this existing framework, we have definition that frame creativity as an ability, an attribute, an attitude, a meta skill, a non-cognitive skill, a soft skill, a 21st century skill, any kind of word relating to personal trait or competencies is associated with creativity. So first outcome is no standard approach exists. However, there are some commonalities across framework explicitly. So between the 59 framework, we see that each of them, this framework, they all include creativity, but not all explicitly. Some, even ours, the key competence recommendation is it mentions it, but it doesn't define it. So it's more implicit. We talk a lot about lifelong learning, so also the learning that professionals in the creativity world create for themselves as a self-regulated pathway, not going back to school because they are already professional, but they keep developing competencies. No matter the fact that we talk a lot about lifelong learning, most framework address school. What is clear is that in the past 10 years, because we were focusing more on the literature from 2009 onwards, creativity is more and more underlined as a unique and important human attribute. And you can, of course, make your own link towards the whole issue of changing nature of work, the transformation of society due to technology and robots. So this important human attribute is underlined more and more. It's often associated with originality, novelty, value, experimentation, and problem solving. And it was curious that in the audience, when we were replying to the Mentimeter question, the value creation part was the one of the least voted. So you were seeing other things like motivation or collaboration as more important. But overall, in literature and in the cases that we have analyzed, there is this focus on originality, novelty, value, experimentation, and problem solving. What is important also to underline is that creativity in the lifelong learning context is thought as, is framed as everyday creativity, something that can be learned and can be practiced every day. It's not the creativity of a genius like Einstein or artistic genius, and you can pick your own examples. There is no time to go in great detail, but what is interesting to highlight is that the differences relate mainly to the visibility and definition of creativity. Sometimes it floats at a higher level, so there are frameworks like the OECD has recently published a report on critical and creative thinking, so clearly visible. Report itself, or it's embedded and less visible, like in our case. Definitions are broader or narrower. Sometimes they focus more on the divergence aspect of creativity, or they focus more on aspect relating to converging on products, on ideas that are tangible. Collaboration is always mentioned, but creativity is seen as an individual and not a social competence. Other interesting aspect to highlight. Ubiquity of creativity is not contended. So there is agreement that creativity is transversal to any walk of life, not only to any sector of education, but applies to all aspects of life. Although there are some frameworks that still relate it very much to historically to the art sector. And this is also in the council recommendation. For instance, cultural awareness and expression is one of the competencies in which creativity is mentioned explicitly because of this historic association. General remark I can make is that creativity is more and more treated as a competence and not a discipline. It's not by chance that also among you, 96% of the respondents to the Mentimeter were seeing it not as a standalone competence or a standalone element to be studied by itself, but more of a transversal one, a competence. It's often mentioned as an objective. Sometimes it's mentioned as associated with the methodologies for teaching, but detailed definition are generally lacking, not to mention learning outcome statements that are really detailed description on how, on what is expected to be achieved by a learner and often associated to a progression. So learning outcome statements that are simpler when you are a beginner and are more articulated where you are an expert. There is often this link with critical thinking and innovation that can be arguable. And sometimes there is more focus on creative thinking, so the cognition part, and sometimes there is more focus on action. So creating something, acting upon ideas to turn them into something tangible. For teaching and learning, and this is message goes particularly to the DEOS project, and it's interesting that it's related to VET, so vocational education, professional settings. Most pedagogies that embed creativity as a competence, transversal competence, mimic the real world. So our project-based learning, they create challenges that are tangible, so that people engage in active creation of something new, creative. When it comes to assessment, because of all I said before, there is a lot of confusion, or a lot of variety rather than confusion. Some people, I start from the last point, don't even think that assessment is relevant when we talk about creativity. Creativity happens, it has to be fostered, but it has not to be assessed. Other people say exactly the opposite. If you don't assess, it's not important. So it's important to have clear learning objective, outcomes, and setting standards so that you can measure and you can demonstrate that learning has happened and further demonstrate the impact of this learning. In general, what you see is that there is a plethora of assessment instruments that are used. Normally is self-assessment, self-reflection. So learners are asked to reflect. Since many of the case study relate to projects, they report on activity and outputs rather than administering tests to participants at the beginning or end at the end of the treatment, so to say, the experience. So if DEUS develops a methodology to teach, it has the chance to say this is what we did, or it has the chance to say, okay, we tested creativity this and this way at the beginning, we administered our training, and then we tested creativity at the end in this and this other way, and this is the result. So the two approaches exist. So for us, JRC, European Commission, policy side of the world, the challenges and implication of this study are relating to how important it is at European level to give more visibility to creativity and where it has to be done. Because you also have to consider that on the world of education, the Commission is has not hard power, so we don't do law that apply to all member states. Totally the contrary, that's the subsidiarity principle. Member states are responsible for their education system. So there are countries in which giving specific learning outcomes and associating them with specific pedagogies would disrupt current very successful practices. Like I mentioned Finland because they have been experimenting with creativity many years and they have a lot of flexibility in doing so. There are other countries in which maybe guidelines would be more appreciated. One solution cannot fit all, but these are the questions that we are facing. Now, what are the questions you are facing? This is my last slide. These are you can follow our work here. But I think I've exceeded a bit the 15 minutes I were given, but overall, it's up to you now to make questions if I can address them or share your concern as practitioner, business support organization, or educational organization, and the others that we don't know who they are.
Thanks a lot, Margherita, for your very comprehensive, insightful presentation. I think that we have a very good starting point for our discussion. So creativity is so very difficult to define, even more difficult to assess, and yet very important to foster. So I would like, before we open up the floor to the audience, to ask Georgios to bring us back to Mentimeter for the last question. And I hope that then people will come up with further questions to Margherita. The question that Georgios will talk about in a moment is about how to drive the success of initiatives aimed at fostering creativity as a transversal skill. So what are the key elements that we should bear in mind? And for this question, which we have designed a bit differently, we ask you to rank those proposals, whether you strongly agree or disagree, so that Margherita can also see how we position ourselves on that radar.
Exactly. Thank you, Benoit. And as Benoit said, how to drive the success of initiatives aimed at fostering creativity as a transversal skill. So you are strongly agree with everything until now. Framing the development of creativity within higher objectives, it's on 3.6, so there are some that are disagreeing, and it's falling
down. We only have six of you participating, and we have 56 people here following this webinar with the JRC. So it's only right now, 10% of you have actually gone to menti.com, menti.com, and used the code 60211537. And if you do that, you can let your opinion be heard. Also ask questions. So grab your smartphone, menti.com/6021-1537, and we're really interested in knowing what you think.
If I put my cursor closely, you can see also the answers here. Okay. Most of you are agreeing that highlighting the importance of creativity for employability and business outcomes.
And this could almost be like a racehorse where we could say, those of you who have the right one will get €5 each. No extensions, substitutions, or refunds.
And the same with engaging students and teachers together.
Okay. Marieta, do you want to comment on the results? There are two proposals that seem to stand out. So highlighting the importance of creativity for employability and business outcomes. And the second most highly ranked proposal would be engaging students and teachers together.
Yes, well the first one, the highlighting the importance of creativity for employability and business outcomes, is something that comes out also from the report, showing the value of creativity is important both for teachers and for learners. It's good to see that from the practitioner side or the people participating to this workshop, there is this emphasis too. And the other one, the learning outcomes, is something that we are considering, and it's nice to see that there is a demand for that. The aspect of engaging students and teachers together, again, is one of the key aspects, I think, of any modern approach to education where learning is learner-centered. Therefore, a teacher play a role of mentoring, supporting learner in their pathways that most often become more and more individual and also enriched by external experience out of the education system. The availability, especially now, we have all seen that beyond going to the digital education due to the closure of school for the lockdown, many people beyond even in adult learning, lifelong learning, many people have used open educational resources to upskill. And in that case, they are the leader of their own learning. So they are the subject that generate the pathways, and they interact with stakeholders that can be teacher or mentors or provider of knowledge in different ways. So I think that participants are aware of the trends and see and reflect that the study has hit on the right right dimension. So hitting on what the education system is trying to do, the lifelong learning system is trying to do. And of course, the case study are the more innovative. So it's nice to see that there is alignment on that from my side.
Great. Okay, I think we should stop here with the Mentimeter and let's follow up with the discussion.
We already have two questions in the chat. I'll give priority to those two. From Juan Pastor, do you want to ask your question yourself? Go ahead.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Margarete. My question is, could you tell us more about more countries that are working on creativity, like lifelong learning? And how about Spain? I think you are based in Sevilla, and I don't know if just based or because Spain is support all of this. That could be
no, Spain is for me. Is not supporting. So we are part of the commission. We are based in Sevilla. We could be anywhere else. And actually, giving a picture of Spain is very difficult because education system are at autonomous level at regional level. So if you look into the reports, especially in the literature review, you will find that we highlighted a few national framework that have been created by governments that are very strong in advocating for creativity, especially in the Anglo-Saxon world. So there is the state of Victoria in Australia, and then there is a Canadian framework. So it is more on the Anglo-Saxon world where we see at least what literature is always a bit slow in picking up trends, but the existing framework that we scouted, and I must say that we also had a bias on language, so we were not looking for things that was not published in English, so that maybe in Spanish-speaking country there might be framework that that have come up in the past 10 years, but we haven't captured them.
Okay, thank you very much.
We have another question from Paola. Please.
Okay, I could just give a little bit of context of the question, because I know a lot of practitioners are working with the concept of creative confidence, you know, to build creative confidence in people to tackle and solve problems. And I know that IDEO also works with this. And I was interested if in your study you saw any difference between creative confidence and creativity as a competence, if you met these two different terms that might be, you know, there might be similarities between creative confidence and creativity, but I was just wondering if you had any results on this.
Well, the framing of the study is inserted in our work on key competencies. So we focused on creativity, creative thinking as broad concept, but still defined as creativity or maximum creative thinking. If you look in the entrepreneurship competence framework, Entrecomp, you will see that there is one competence that is called self-awareness and self-efficacy, which again overlaps and intertwines with the other 15. And actually one of the issues is that the Entrecomp, this entrepreneurship competence framework, defines creativity as one of its 15 competencies. So in that case, you can see that self-awareness and self-efficacy and creativity are both competencies that are required to act upon ideas and opportunity to create value for others, which is the definition that we use. So I totally agree with you that creativity, as any other competence, is associated with self-efficacy and the capacity to stage it. But I wouldn't say, I don't recollect that we have a specific focus on creative confidence in the study.
Thank you so much.
Margherita, when you started researching the topic with your colleagues from the GRC, you identified several educational frameworks, some mentioning creativity as explicit, others as implicit. Could you identify any reasons to explain this divergence across member states? Is it due to culture? Is it due to history? Did you have the chance to interview any of your stakeholders within the different ministries? What could explain such a diversity within Europe?
We haven't digged into the reason. I think there is a cultural component that is behind, also driven by how much interest there is on the standardization and measurement of the competence. You may be aware that the PISA, the International Student Assessment Survey conducted by the OECD on 15 years old students, which is the benchmark against which states measure themselves to say, we are top tier in the PISA results, or we are bottom, we are performing better than the last survey, and we are aiming at better, is now coming up in 2022 with the section on creative thinking. So, but there is a strong tension there, because if you standardize the measurement, then you are likely to narrow the understanding of what creativity is. So I would say that one of the possible reason for leaving it broader is to leave more dimension to be explored, and to the other reason is, okay, let's pin it down, define it in a way, create objective learning outcome statement, rubrics to assess, but this encounters a lot of resistance because, as I mentioned, many practitioners say creativity has to be fostered, but is fostering a process, fostering an interaction with reality that cannot be tested with a test. So therefore, we don't even test it because we don't foster this approach to creativity. So there is this tension whether measuring narrows the understanding and not measuring allows for more dimension of creativity to be explored and developed.
Thank you, Margherita. We have another question from the audience, from Becky, who's working at Matera Basilicata 2019 Foundation, so the former European Capital of Culture. Becky, please, the floor is yours.
Hi, thank you, Benoit. Good morning, everyone. Just a question, you know, the question regarding definition and defining creativity has been recognized as being a big problem. Do you think, Margherita, that it is possible to create a definition that could be universally promoted and recognized? And then following on from that, do you think there could be the potential for a framework that is specifically focusing on creativity, bearing in mind that it's so transversal, it's in all the frameworks in some way. And obviously with LifeComp, there's lots of connections regarding creativity competences. Just to try and understand if it can help be promoted with clarity of definition and therefore branding, if you like.
Can I just suggest, Margherita, that you put it into context of sustainability competences?
Yes, yes. I was going to do this with Erasmus because this is the challenges. So defining something and giving it visibility, give it primacy. So if you want to give primacy to creativity, then you have to define it and create a framework, create consensus. Also, the way we work at the JRC in creating this framework is not that we are the best scientists. I take myself an example. I'm the person that worked on Entrecom, the Entrepreneurship Competence Framework. My previous job was designing milk factory interfaces for the global market. So, expert in entrepreneurship, the best scientist in entrepreneurship ever? Definitely not. My job, though, was to foster consensus, which is what we do at the Commission. We bring different stakeholders and say, guys, you are the expert, either from the academia or from the practitioner world, the education world. Let's come together and agree on a definition. So if we wanted to give creativity a top priority, we should do the same. Now we have the 8 key competencies where creativity is below. There has been a revision of the key competence framework in 2017 before the 2018 new recommendation came out. And this was discussed and there was no agreement on the topic. However, there had not been pandemic at the time. So for instance, the social emotional learning is not so clearly present in the key competence framework, although social emotional learning, creativity have been pushed to the forefront because they are instruments that allow each of us as individual, family, schools, organization, countries to cope with this unforeseen situation. And the same is true for sustainability competencies. In the revision, in the process of revising the 2006 recommendation, participatory process, people were consulted and many people said sustainability competencies are important. However, overall, the perception was that key competencies were the ones that are needed to show sustainable thinking and sustainable action. Priority change from, so what I want to say is that it's partly a reflection of what is out there, a part a reflection of the political will, a part of a reflection of how society changes. So can we add to the 8 key competencies creativity? Shall we then add sustainability? And how about artificial intelligence and coping with robots? It can become it can become a chaos if we start generating framework. Nevertheless, I don't think that this key competence framework or any other framework, unless I take the case of the Victoria State in Australia, they have a framework that they base their education system on. So that's a strongly governmental decision. They do it and they do it this way. But imagine that, Becky, you are the responsible for the implementation of a framework for the creative industry. And you can take EntreComp, LifeComp, whatever comp you find out there, whatever framework, bring the bricks that are in the boxes. Imagine Lego boxes. One box is the EntreComp, one other is the LifeComp, the third is the DigComp. And let's imagine that the yellow bricks inside are the creativity. Nobody prevents you from taking all the bricks, the yellow bricks, and build a yellow castle. So this framework have to be understood as flexible instruments. So from a practitioner point of view or from a project point of view, they have to be used as references, not as standard. So there is flexibility. But the question, should creativity be given more visibility, is a top one. And we are working on it. It's the driving question of our study.
Yeah, because it's very closely linked, therefore, then onto assessment. And that's something we're studying in the DELS project. You know, We recognize, we've created our own DELS comp, which we've recognized is a mixture of all the comps that creatives need in terms of upskilling. But the next step is how to assess it and how to benchmark that assessment. Yeah. Thank you.
PISA and OECD are starting to do that in 2022 with this new section of their International Student Assessment Survey. So it's clear that this is becoming more and more important and more relevant to take a decision on. Again, we do the research, then it's policymaker making the policy decisions.
But definitions are always difficult. We have had in the past at CBN a mobility challenge, you know, where startups can give ideas on to increase mobility. And mobility for some is being able to find a parking spot, like in Tel Aviv, where you spend 10% of your life trying to find a parking spot. And for others, mobility is to create a burkini, a burqa, and a swimsuit at the same time, so you as a woman can go to the beach. So also with creativity and sustainability, I don't think there will ever be a consensus. And I think it's also, as Becky also mentioned, a question of putting it in the framework that is suitable for the discussion.
But I can give you the example of entrepreneurship. If you take existing definition of entrepreneurship, there are hundreds. And they most come from the business school kind of world. However, when you take the lifelong learning perspective, you cannot take the consensus that comes from the business world and splash it on top of primary education, because rightly so, you would have a revolution, because people would say you're trying to sell education to the business world. And so it seems impossible, but at the end of the day, EntreComp is a framework that is very, very broad. Nevertheless, is the only framework among the one that we have produced, which has arrived to 8 level of proficiency and 442 learning outcomes based on consensus. So far from being perfect and from being the definitive one and only definition of entrepreneurship, is one that is broad enough, consensual enough to bring on the same page people that are creating new innovative activities in primary education, in better education, and that are trying to promote a more entrepreneurial behavior within existing venture and organization with their employees. So I believe, based on my experience, that this consensus building process can be created. And more that maybe the dialogue has to be international, beyond even the European member state kind of dimension. So since the OECD has a large constituency, and the UNESCO, the United Nations, and these competencies are relevant for anyone, not only people in member states in Europe, I think that process can be fostered to create common definition, but they have to be broad, because the definition that suits creative graphic designer is not the one that suits shoemaker, although maybe the greatest creativity, just provoking, comes from the shoemaker world.
Margherita, we've got some more questions in the chat. I would like to bring in Mauro, who asked a question already some time ago. Sorry for making you waiting, Mauro. Please, the floor is yours. Go ahead.
Just wanted to ask to Margherita, but to all of you, if some of you have to do in his work and his daily thinking about creativity with children, especially with little children. Just a question, just to know, you can do some, because for me it's very important. I have this luck. I have my wife in the other room with little children at school. It's funny, it's really funny. I help them. I work in a bank, but I prefer to stay in his room sometimes. And I think they are a continuous and fresh source of creativity that we all often forget to use, and forget to use to be more happy and more focused on creativity work. Thank you.
Does anyone want to reply instead of me?
I would. Hi, Mauro. Thanks for being here. I would just add something to what you said. I totally agree with you. And in fact, in my opinion, the problem that we have with creativity is related to school education system. I'm sorry, but I'm strongly convinced that this is like that, because kids, when they are, very young, they are free to do whatever they want, because it belongs to their freedom of being kids, of being child, to their childhood, this freedom to be creative and to be crazy and to do, to say whatever they want without feeling judged. When we grow up and we are in the school system, we have to follow a precise path where we are mostly not allowed to be very creative. So if you have to solve, I have to say, if you have homeworks to do, you have to follow a precise tasks and a precise methodology. And it's very hard to find teacher that will, accept divergent solutions or open discussions about a topic, around a topic. So I think that indeed, we should try to foster and to highlight the importance of creativity in the schools and in civil society. Sometimes we see creatives, I'm a creative professional, and I can feel on my skin that sometimes creatives are considered like odd people, doing something strange. But indeed, if we foster creativity as a key tool for communities to reshape themselves, to solve challenges, to be active in the social life, I think that the perspective might be really different, but the schools have a very important role to me.
Thank you, Rita. Rita, I just want to add a thought to my question. That is that when we talk of creativity, we need a simple languages, not technical. We must force ourselves to use simple words, very little words, as if we should have some children listening to us. Every time that we talk of creativity and to put it as a top objective. Thank you.
That brings us back to this everyday creativity that Margherita was introducing at the beginning, and also Rita, what you were saying, creativity as a driving force behind change, and change that we need to face the challenges of today. I would like to give the floor to Ivona, who has an additional question going back to the policy level. Ivona, please.
Thank you very much. I'm very much interested in the supply chain of what when we talk about creativity. So let's say the policy is made on the European level and what is happening there. So there it's probably introduced to the countries and the countries who have the power to introduce it, to implement or not. And what is happening probably very often, nothing is happening, right? Because creativity is not the strategic point. So my question here is there from the European level, is there any will, political will to lobby this topic so the needed implementations will be introduced in the countries and also implemented then later on the school level? Because what I'm thinking right now is that we don't need just, you know, policies and beautiful curricula, but we need the willingness or the will from all of the stakeholders. And that requires like a system change in the education. Your thoughts, Margarita, on this one would really interest me. Thank you.
You have the overarching question. What can I say? I can say that for the mandate of the Commission, the political will is embedded in this council recommendation. So member states saying we take what the Commission says as an advice. So there is normally a Commission proposal to the council, council adopt and recommends. So member states say, okay, we believe. Then the strength of the belief of the 27th member state may be different. So there might be countries where the political will is more bigger and others where it is less. What the Commission does is to foster a lot of exchange of practices. Don't remember that the Commission is not throwing money to projects out of nothing with no priority. So the fact that projects are funded to foster creativity and to foster it in vocational education rather than in primary school or in arts college shows the political will to support that these things is turned from the policy document into the practices. So you see it yourself in, for instance, I can, again, I have to refer to my key area of expertise, entrepreneurial competencies. In the past 7 years, the number of projects funded that refer to Entrecomp has reached 7 years too much. It's 2016 when the project was, the framework came out. In the past 5 years, we have reached 93 EU-funded projects that make an explicit reference to Entrecomp. So the Commission supports, but of course, it's a long game in which multiple stakeholders have to intervene. I think that part of the work that we can see here today with the CBN bringing us together is also to raise awareness that there is this kind of work at the Commission level. The fact that the DIUS project is the one who has activated the invitation, so to say, to give the presentation is this idea that on the grassroots there is also a role to demand for more. So I think it's a multi-stakeholder endeavor. So it won't come only because the Commission says it or because a member state says it, but it's a long process of trying to transform education that making reference to what Rita was saying, education system for many years and in many places have been based on knowledge transmission. So they were the place where people were made to learn about the history of their countries in which school system was born together with the country, more or less like mine. So teaching about the unification of the country and the knowledge that we were one country was very important. Once you know for your exam, you forget. Now all the education system see the need for a transformation from knowledge to competence, to integrate at least competencies, not if not to substitute knowledge with competencies. But the integration of key competencies is happening. It might happen at different speed, but for sure it completes the knowledge aspect with the skills, the ability to do things and the attitudes. So the ability to be a citizen in a different way. before maybe we were expected to lose the creativity we had as children, to lose it when we were going to the funnel of education, and the more and more we became specialized, the less creative we were, and maybe this fitted the society 50 years ago, but now it doesn't fit anymore. So I see the transformation coming, maybe slowly, but it's coming.